Hello to all of our listeners, and welcome back to The Parent Solution, your one-stop shop for all things educational. Today is a guest episode, and I have a great guest with me today. Her name is Anne Montgomery. Anne has a varied background, which includes 20 years of teaching in a Title I school. She also became a foster mom to four children later in life, so she can speak about education issues, which we're going to talk about today, as well as parenting the next generation. Just a little short biography for her. Anne has worked as a television sportscaster, a newspaper and magazine writer, a teacher, an author, and an amateur sports official. Her first TV job came at WRBL-TV, which was in Columbus, Georgia, and it led to positions at WROC-TV in Rochester, New York, KTSP-TV in Phoenix, Arizona, and ESPN in Bristol, Connecticut. She actually anchored the Emmy and ACE award-winning Sports Center in Connecticut as well. She finished her on-camera broadcasting career with a two-year stint as the studio host for the NBA's Phoenix Sun, and she was a freelance staff reporter for six publications. She wrote sports, features, movie reviews, and archaeological pieces. Her novels include The Castle, A Light in the Desert, Wild Horses on the Salt, The Scent of Rain, and Wolfcatcher. Some of those are definitely on my summer reading list. She taught sports reporting at Arizona State University's Walter Cronkite School of Journalism and Mass Communication, and she taught high school journalism for 20 years. She was an amateur sports official for four decades, a time during which she called baseball, ice hockey, soccer, and basketball games, and she served as a high school football referee and a crew chief. Montgomery is a foster mom to three sons and a daughter. And when she can, she indulges in her passions, which are rock collecting, scuba diving, musical theater, and playing her guitar. What an introduction. Thank you, Anne, for being here today.
Thank you for inviting me. I'm glad to be here.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Did I miss anything in your intro?
I don't think so. That sounded pretty good. It's been quite an adventure, I have to say.
You've got quite the experience behind you. And it's nice to see that you've got such a varied experience as well. Life experience, we might call it.
And you know, for me as a teacher, that's the most important thing we can teach young people is to not just do one thing, not just to be comfortable playing football or playing the violin, to get out there and do lots of different things. Because what I've learned is that sometimes you can't do those things anymore. And when that one thing ends, you're lost. So I think the more things we can get involved in, the better. And that's something that's very important that we teach our young people.
I would agree. I think I would caution, and maybe you have some insights on this, I think I would caution on getting involved in too many things.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, you don't want to overcommit, but exploring different options, I think, is definitely something to be commended, for sure.
And today, unfortunately, especially in sports and actually in lots of things, parents get so focused on one idea. My child will be an NFL quarterback. So all the 12 months a year, that's all they're going to do. And that's ridiculous because it just leads to burnout. So I, especially as a high school teacher, I really felt that was the time kids should be exploring new things, trying new things, because as adults, we rarely do that. Adults are afraid of looking silly in front of other adults. So we need to encourage young people to step out of their comfort zones and say, you know, I'm going to try marching band. I'm going to try theater. I'm going to try art or dance or whatever those things are. And they don't have to be great at them, but the idea is to get out there and try. And I think too many parents either do, as you said, and make them do too many things, too many scripted things. And then other ones concentrate on that one thing because dad wanted to be a major league baseball player. So now they're going to make their kid a baseball player, even if the kid wants to play the cello. So I think we need to listen to our kids a little bit more, but also expand their horizons. There's so many wonderful things to do in the world. And I think sometimes they're missing out on them while they're staring at their phones.
Yeah, I would say I'm a huge advocate for technology. I think that it's an important aspect of life. And the fact is, technology marches on, whether you like it or not. That's not changing anytime soon, you know, bar like World War III or something like some major cataclysmic event, right? But barring that happening, it's really, really important to be technologically literate. And I know digital literacy is a really big thing that we focus on. with your experience, and if I'm not mistaken, it's 20 years of teaching in a Title I school. Yeah. With your experience, maybe you can share some insights of technology and kind of the rise of technology, and maybe some of your experiences with that as a teacher and even as a foster mom too.
Yeah. When I started teaching 2000, I started teaching at the age of 45. So I'm like a third career teacher. Mm-hmm. And I was at first frustrated with technology because every other week, it seems like they gave us new programs. You know, they gave us new computers. We went from Macs to PCs. And, you know, I didn't grow up in that world, but you have to do it. It's part of life. And I think technology can be a great thing for kids if it's utilized mindfully and not that they're on their phones. As a teacher, and you can ask any teacher this, when kids have cell phones constantly, it's very difficult to teach them. And I know because they're always under their desks with them. And yeah. I was very frustrated. And I will be very honest with you. When I retired at 65, that's when I finally got a cell phone. I intentionally didn't want one. And it wasn't that I was a technophobe at all. I mean, I taught journalism where we put newspapers together using, you know, online stuff. Mm-hmm. I know how to handle, you know, a computer. I write books. So it's not that I'm a technophobe. It's mm-hmm. that the constant battle with kids to put the phones away and to pay attention to what's happening in class is a nightmare. And anybody who doesn't believe me needs to stand in front of a classroom for 10 minutes. Because the kids are so hooked on that. And I don't mean for good purposes, like let's look up something important on your phone. You know, they're playing games. And, you know, I was in high school, so who knows what those kids were looking at. I mean, I know there were a lot of things, and then they're tweeting each other and constantly in touch, and they don't pay attention in class. There need to be rules about that. And when I was teaching, schools were going, what do we do with this? We can't tell them not to have phones. But at the same time, we have technology. We had great technology in my school. Kids had computers, laptops, and all kinds of things. But it was the phones that were the most difficult to deal with. And I have a phone now. I the best part to me about it is the camera. I like the camera part. But the rest of it, it's like having a pet. It's constantly chirping at me, and I don't know what it wants. So I don't know. I agree with you. Of course, we need technology. It's going to be ever changing, but there need to be some parents need to make some rules about it. I mean, mm-hmm. I don't know about you, but if we're all sitting down and eating and we're not watching a movie or something, there's no phones at the table. We don't do that. So, but it's very difficult. You know, some of my kids are all in their 20s now, and you know, it's like embedded in their hands. So, right. You know, I'm not sure. I mean, I absolutely agree. Technology has been an incredible change in our world, and much of it is good, but much of it is not.
Right. And so it's funny. I had a little bit of deja vu there when you said no phones at the table. I was brought back about 13, 14 years because my parents said the same thing. No phones at the table. I don't even think I actually didn't even get a phone until I was 17, 16, 17. I was in grade 10 or grade 11, and it was because I was on the wrestling team. That's why I got a phone, because I needed to be able to contact my parents without having to rely on strangers for their phones or whatnot, right? Again, there was a sense of responsibility that was imbued with the privilege of having that technology, right? But we were taught in my house anyways, and in my family from a very young age that yes, technology is a great thing. You can definitely use it to your advantage, but there are certain restrictions. There are certain things that you need to respect about technology. My dad being in IT when he was in his younger days, and actually up until I was, I think probably 10 or 11, he worked in the IT department for a major company, building a lot of their software and things like that, because I was born kind of when the age of the internet started happening, right? And one of the things that he said to me was, you make sure, and he said to all of us kids, you make sure you're very careful about the things that you view online, the things that you put online, because it is so digital literacy and digital competency was something that was imbued from a very young age. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Obviously, age appropriateness, your 3-year-old does not need to be sitting there with an iPad, right?
No, but people do that. I see people
in my opinion.
Kids. And the other thing is, when you say digital literacy, it's also about being able to I'm going to stop. Is that noise bothering you?
No.
My son is taking a shower.
I can't hear.
I will continue then. There's several problems I find. First of all, digital literacy in my world also includes the ability to look at a piece of information and determine if it's real. Is it true? I taught this. I'm like, please, we have so much stuff that's completely made up on the internet. And I taught my students, how do you determine? Look at the sources. Look at who they're interviewing. I saw this whole big thing that quoted a dentist on this fantastical new medication, doctor whoever didn't exist. How did I know? It took me 15 seconds to determine the man was made up character in this advertisement. So my point is digital literacy in my world is being able to determine what's real and what's not. And too many of my students would put something, go to a search engine, put a question in, and they would take the absolute first thing that appeared without knowing, without looking into where did it come from? Do they have a bias? And that was very frustrating for me. The other problem is it used to be kids stayed after school and went to, clubs and sports and, mm-hmm. and practice. I was at a school. My school's big. We had 2,000 kids in our school, and the same 100 kids participated in all the clubs and all the sports. All the rest of the kids did not. Now, there are varying reasons for that, but quite honestly, most of them wanted to run home and play video games or hang out on their phones. And I was so upset by that. I said, this is the time in your life when you need to explore what you might be good at. And if you're spending 5 hours a day playing a video game, maybe you're developing some skills there. We know you are, but socialization is not happening. Mm-hmm. Learning how to deal with other people. I mean, people who are not into sports don't seem to understand how important that world can be. It's the same in drama. It's the same in music. You learn how to deal with other people. You learn how to follow rules. You learn how to be punctual. You learn how to take orders. You learn how to rein in your emotions when, emotions get high. These are business skills. And it's not about being the best football player or being a state championship team. It's about being able to play nice with others. And that's what we need to do in the business world. So I worry that being a play, it's the same thing. You need to be on time when the curtain goes up. And so many young people don't seem to think being on time is important. I would get so frustrated when kids would say, I'm just 5 minutes late. I'm like, it was in television. If I was 1 second late when the camera went on and my seat was empty on the anchor desk, I'm out of a job. There's no one there.
You would have been fired.
Yeah. So my concern is that kids are so tied up with the digital world that they're not getting out there in the real world. And I know my kids were like, well, yeah, but we have friends online. I'm like, yes, but it's totally different when you have to look somebody in the eye and read them. And I think a lot of young people don't know how to read emotions in people's faces. They're so used to communicating via text.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know about you, but I've gotten text messages that I totally misconstrued because I didn't see the person. I thought they were mad, but they weren't. So how do young people learn to read emotions if they're not actually with other human beings? So this was my big struggle. I don't have anything against technology in general. It probably can help us a lot. But I think for young people, we need to get them out and socializing with their phones put away at least part of the day.
Right. Right. And I sense this is something that is a common theme I find when I talk to a lot of, one second, Tank, you stay. Gracious, trying to record a podcast and I had a dog flopping around like a dead
fish. Yeah, I usually have a cat that walks right through. I'm like, sorry, cat.
Well, that's okay. There's no video. It's just audio. Right.
Yeah.
All right. This is why I edit. See, this is why I don't record live.
Yeah.
and this is the thing. I know a lot of educators, every educator that I talk to and, a lot of parents that I talk to as well, that is a concern is the overconsumption. And the ties that a lot of kids have to their phones, right? As an adult, as someone who's 29, I don't own a phone. And my husband doesn't either. We used to. The reason that we don't is because we live outside in the middle of nowhere, not outside, but we live in the middle of nowhere where there's no cell phone service. And so a phone would be kind of pointless, right? Now we're fortunate to have internet, satellite internet works just fine. And so we can communicate in that way as well. And then there's voice over IP and other options, right? But the point being that you can, I can close my laptop and walk away and I'm done. I'm not tempted to pick up the phone because there is no phone, right? There's no other sort of distraction. So if I want to go for a walk, I can, right? I can just shut my laptop and go. When you have something that is small and it's tied to you all the time, in a lot of teenagers' cases, it's difficult to implement those sorts of boundaries, perhaps. Did you, when you were an educator, ever collaborate with parents in terms of this sort of technology issue? Did you ever have any suggestions for parents? Was that a conversation that came up at all?
We were told that it wasn't our business. Basically, our school said you can't take their phone. And I did take kids' phones. I did. I had a big vault in my room that kept computers. And if kids didn't listen, I took them. And oh my God, giant football players would weep when you took their phone away. And I said, look, I just need you to try to concentrate on something else.
Right. While you're in my class.
Right.
And while you're in my class.
Yeah. After a while, all the teachers gave up. And then we had new young teachers coming in who had Bluetooth things in their ears all during class. And that really bugged me. I'm like, what is that telling students that you must be plugged in? To me, that's just an ego trip. I am so important. I must be plugged in all the time. And I got to tell you, my partner of 30 years and I, he and I did not get phones until I retired at 65 because it's really hard to travel if you don't have a cell phone. If your flight's delayed, you get the thing that, and it's really hard. You can't get an Uber. You can't do much of anything. And so for me, the phone, you know, I understand that I'm old. I didn't grow up with this technology, but I'm with you. I go to the health club. I leave it in the car. They go, where's your phone to check in? I said, I don't want to bring my phone in here. I don't want to have that with me. Yeah. And here in Arizona, as I'm a rock collector and I've been a lot of wilderness areas, there's no phones. You know, people go, well, if you get lost, they're just our phones. Let's be honest.
Right.
And I don't feel a constant need to have one and to be
right
to hold it. But kids, my last 10 years of school, there's a serious addiction.
Mm-hmm.
And we know it's changing their brains. Especially when parents are handing 2-year-olds tablets to play with.
Yeah.
And their brains are being rewired. Now, what this is going to do, I don't know. All I know is that the socialization is the part that upsets me. When you have a kid, I had a lot of freshmen. I taught a communications class where I taught kids public speaking and how to find out if something's true on the internet and all sorts of communication things. And kids that were so withdrawn and I couldn't get them to participate in other things. All they wanted to do was look in their phones because that's where they were comfortable. And we can't, how are we going to have a society where people are only comfortable looking at a screen? And I don't mean looking at a screen like I can see you now. Yeah. This, they don't look at any people.
Right.
They just tweet. Or they play games. I had kids tell me that their only friends were people online. And I'm thinking they could be playing their game against a 54-year-old in New Zealand. And they think those are the friends. I'm like, no, you have to put it away. Yeah, please go out and join a sport or, you know, play in the marching band, something for that socialization. And I think it's going to be a big problem. I really do.
Yeah. And I think, and I mean, like I said, there's nothing wrong. Like I don't think that there's anything wrong with striking a balance, right? And finding a balance between how to utilize technology. I mean, even just in terms of educational purposes, right? Or sorry, entertainment purposes, right? If you want to play video games or whatever, I mean, age appropriateness, of course, that's a little bit of a different discussion. But if you want to use technology for entertainment, what are some of the restrictions that are going to be placed on you? I remember when I was in school and I was still living at home, even in high school, we had strict regulations. We were allowed to use it, you know, for research purposes and whatever if we needed to do homework. But in terms of entertainment, we had an hour and a half max. And obviously myself being the oldest, I got more time than my sister, who's 6 years younger than I am, right? Not by much, like maybe an extra hour or whatever. She was only allowed half an hour. I had an hour or 45 minutes extra or whatever. But point being, there were boundaries in place. There were restrictions in place. And I was taught to respect those. And when my time was up, playing whatever game I was playing or doing whatever, and watching whatever I was watching that wasn't necessary, even if it was educational, my parents just said to me, hey, it's not good for you to be looking at a screen so much. Let's take that back a little bit. Go outside. Find something to do.
Yes, go outside. You know, you remind me, that reminds me of my parents, and you, the people are going to think I'm ancient, but when I was a kid, we were not allowed to watch television Monday through Thursday. My parents called it the boob tube. And we thought that was
my dad.
Yeah, we thought they were so old fashioned. But now we look back on it, we all, well, two of out of three of us participated in a lot of things. And I don't, people say, oh, remember this TV show? And I'm like, no, we didn't watch TV. We watched TV on Friday, Saturday, or Sunday. That was the only time you could watch TV because they wanted you. I mean, we would run home from school and throw on our shorts or our jeans and go out and play. And there were no parents telling us how to play. 10 kids from the neighborhood would get together. And we had to learn on our own how to socialize. We had to learn on our own how to stop bullying. You know, we didn't have parents standing there or, you know, controlling every moment of everything we did. But I believe that while technology is a wonderful thing in many ways, it is so overly used. And now we're going to have people who grew up holding the phone or the tablet as little kids, and now they're going to make babies. How's that going to be?
Right.
Are they going to put any restrictions on their children? I don't know.
Right. And so making sure that you're aware of these things, I think, is really important as a parent, regardless of what age you are. And I think that as with anything, right, everything in moderation. If your child said that they wanted to eat junk food all day, well, like, sweetheart, that's great. But let's look at the nutritional impacts of that, right? And some kids might, at 4 or 5 years old, they want to eat candy and sugar and ice cream and whatever. And some kids don't. They want to eat vegetables all day. And that's a little bit, like, every child is different, right? But when it comes to a lot of concepts, it's putting those boundaries in place of what is healthy for your brain and or your body and what is not. And I would hope that most parents and most people would be able to exercise some common sense in that regard.
Here's something too. This is not a scientific study. It's just an observation of mine over 20 years of teaching. Mm-hmm. I found the kid. I interviewed all my kids individually, probably every student I've ever had. Would sit them down and go, where do you see yourself in 10 years? What do you want to, what, you know, that line where you say, what do you want to be when you grow up? Well, we don't think kids can answer that. And I would ask them three questions. I would say, what do you like to do? Mm-hmm. What are you good at? And what will someone pay you to do? Think of those three things when you think of your future. Because if you don't have a job that you like 85% of the time, no one loves it every day, you're not going to like your life. And my students, it was Title I school. They grew up in poverty. So to them, money was the only thing they wanted. Mm-hmm. But I'm like, money alone isn't enough. You have to enjoy what you do to make that money. And what I learned from talking to kids, the ones that seemed to spend the most of the time on their phones, playing video games, and weren't interested in doing anything else, not getting out there and trying. Some kids said, well, I always wanted to play the guitar. I'm like, I'll go to the guitar teacher and I'll get you guitar lessons if you do that. Or the football coach is right across the hall. Let's go talk to him and we'll see if you can get a tryout, right, on the team. Mm-hmm. I tried to do these things. And most of the kids went, nope, don't want to do it. And they spent their time mostly on video games and things. And those were the most depressed children I had.
Yeah.
So I could see a correlation between no social involvement and depression. And we have a lot of young people who are depressed. Now, maybe we were depressed when we were kids. I don't know. Nobody paid any attention. But I really think that growing up without socialization skills is extremely difficult. And it's going to make for a whole bunch of unhappy grownups. Because, you know, if you've ever gone into a room where you don't know anybody and there are a whole bunch of people your age. Maybe it's the bar. Maybe it's a meeting. I don't know. If you don't know how to walk in and say hello and shake hands and greet people and say, hey, you know, what do you do for a living? And I worry that a lot of young people don't have those basic skills. And then how do you have a job if you can't do that? I read something like 82% of millennials don't want to talk on the phone. They're terrified of being at work and having to actually answer a phone with their voice.
Yep.
Do you know how terrifying that is? What are we going to do?
Yep. And it's funny because there's so many ways to connect in today's day and age, right? Like realistically, you have so many options. You can video call someone. You can call them on the phone like old school. You can text them. You can email them. You can get a hold of them through a litany of social medias, right? Like there's lots of different ways to connect with people, but you're right. Many people fear showing up like in a phone call, just in a phone call.
We're doing this, a Zoom. They're horrified with the thought that they have to actually look at someone that they're speaking to. I don't know where this is headed, but I wish that, you know, it's funny. My last year of teaching, they canceled all my communications classes.
Really?
So that kids could take, you know, STEM. And I get it. STEM is important, but even engineers need to talk to people.
Of course.
You know, and then they dropped the school newspaper that had been there for 65 years.
Wow.
They wanted kids to take science, technology, engineering, math. They said, we are doing technology here. They're laying out newspapers and magazines on the internet. I mean, this is technology. Nope. They canceled it all because it wasn't, they don't think it's important. I'm like, what are all these people going to do when they can't talk to each other?
Yeah. And that's the thing is communication. Communication has really changed even in, you know, my life. I know you were saying you're old. You're not that old.
I'm 68 and proud to still be here. Thank you.
But I'm sure that you've seen things change. And like you said, in your 68 years of life, you've seen the ways of communication change. And change is, you know, okay, but we have to make sure that we're also keeping up with actual communication, right? True communication, talking to each other. Because when you lose the ability to talk to other people, regardless of whether they are or are not within your sphere of friends, family, right? It's important to be able to talk to people about anything, right? Like you were just saying, a simple, hey, how are you, walking into a room full of strangers or coming into a Zoom room, if you want to put it that way,
yep,
full of strangers and networking with people, talking to people. Like you have to be able to do that. That is technology right there.
But communication. People avoid it. When my student reporters had to go interview somebody, I'm like, go interview the principal. And some of them got it after a while. They were okay, but they were horrified at the thought of going to ask someone two questions. They just struggled. And it broke my heart when they canceled those classes. I said, what's more important than being able to communicate with other human beings? No one listened, but that's okay.
And so this kind of brings it full circle. And I know that it seems that the common theme throughout our conversation today has been communication and encouraging communication. Do you have any tips maybe for parents or suggestions for parents who are looking to maybe cut back on a little bit of the technology usage and or encourage communication with their kids, regardless of whether it's communication with them as the parents or with their teachers or with their friends? Do you have any suggestions for parents who are looking for solutions here?
I think as your parents did and my parents did, there have to be rules in the house. There has to be, we don't do this while the grandma's visiting. You know, we don't take out our phones at the dinner table. We have time where we can all just sit and talk with one another. There's a time and a place for all these things. And it's not 24 hours a day. My problem is many of the parents I dealt with were very young as well. So for them, they didn't see any problem with it. And maybe I'm just old and this is all going to change and being on your phone 24 hours a day will be okay eventually. I don't know. But I think that there have to be rules that parents have to stick to. I also think they should encourage their kids to practice those skills. Like I used to go around and shake hand of every kid in my class. I know that fell out of favor when we had the pandemic, but look someone in the eye and shake their hand. And the kids were like, what are you doing? I'm like, we're going to shake hands. and you're going to look me in the eye.
Powerful.
And when you interview someone as a reporter, you know, that was my job, and you need to look at someone and listen to what they're saying. Mm-hmm. And how do you do that? Parents should practice that with their kids. Look them in the eye when you're talking to them. Don't be on your phone when you're talking to your kid. Drives me crazy when I see family in a restaurant and the parents are on their phones, not talking to their children. I saw two parents do that with three kids. Kids weren't on phones, but the parents were totally ignoring their kids. That is not a good precedent to set.
Right. Leading by example.
Yes. Yeah. So sometimes parents should put their phones away. And if you're having a serious conversation, you don't pick up the phone. Like if I got a phone call now, I'm obviously not going to pick it up. I'm talking to you. And my kids get crazy. They're like, Mom, we called. You didn't pick up the phone. I said, well, I was busy. What if it was an emergency? Call 911. I'm not a doctor. Right? If it's an emergency, call 911.
Right.
I used to tell my students that. What if it's an emergency? Well, okay. 911 is who you call. Not me. Right. I can't fix it. Whatever the problem.
Love it. I love it. And whatever it is, could wait potentially 5 minutes, right?
Everything can, you know, let's be honest. What could somebody possibly need me for that would change everything? Nothing. I mean, if you're in a car accident, okay, call the police, call me, we'll come get you. Right. You know, I get
you have
that.
Other things to take care of first anyway. Right.
And this picking up your phone while you're driving, this is the most insane thing I've ever seen. Nothing. I told them, please, nothing is that important. Nothing. If I get a phone call and I think it might be important, I pull off the road and stop my car. I'm not doing that.
Right.
And yet plenty of people do it. Plenty of adults do it who should know better. You can't drive a car and look at your phone. But now we have screens built in to the front of our cars where we can watch a movie while we're driving. This is technology gone too far.
Right.
It really is. Why does the driver need to be able to see a movie? So yeah, this is disturbing me a lot. I don't know how many people die from doing that, but a lot.
Yeah.
And I think parents need to model that. Like if you're a parent, you're driving your kids around, do not answer your phone ever.
Right. Yep. Because children will be able to relate more to what they see. As your parent, as the parent that you are, than to what you tell them to do. So leading by example is really, really important for sure.
I've learned that parents have no idea how much their children copy them. That you grow up watching the adults in your world behave a certain way and you grow up and behave the same way.
Mm-hmm.
We know this from domestic violence. If daddy beats mommy, a girl is going to find a guy that beats her. This is how we learn, by watching what's normal in our world. And the phone thing, if mom and dad are on the phone 24 hours a day, the child will too do that.
Yep. And I know that that's something that's really, really prevalent in today's society. So hopefully, I'm sure that our listeners have gained something of value from this conversation. Thank you so much, Anne, for your time and your energy. Just before we close this out for today, tell our listeners where they can find you, if they're looking to find you, get in touch with you, or how they might be able to contact you.
Very easy. I have a website, and it's AnneMontgomeryWriter.com. That's Anne with an E, AnneMontgomeryWriter.com.
Beautiful, beautiful. And for those of you who are familiar with the Parent Solution format, you know that the date of this podcast, there's always a corresponding blog that's dropped the day before. That will have all of Anne's links and backlinks and a little bit more about her and her biography and kind of where she's coming from on our website. So if you want everything all in one place, that's www.starstudents.co, or you can just head directly to Anne's website as well. Thank you, Anne. I really appreciate all of your time and your attention. And thank you for showing up today.
Well, thank you for having me. I've enjoyed it.